did two C.A. Stevens books, and has long been the friends of C.A. Stevens. In fact, some people think he is C.A. Stevens, the only friend of C.A. Stevens in many ways. No, he isn't really, but he's really the person you think of when you think of friends of C.A. Stevens. So I think we're really lucky to have him come here tonight to talk about C.A. Stevens and his cousins and family and friends and whoever else you're going to throw into the pot here. But without further ado, I'd like to present Larry Glatz, who will carry on from here. Thank you.
First, I have to move a bit of furniture here. Different subjects. The subject seems to be C.A. Stevens all the time. I saw Ben come in and I said, Ben, haven't you heard this story before? And he's here, nevertheless. Before I begin, I did want to, I can't let a party flag salute go by without reminding people that the flag salute comes to us compliments of the Youth Companion, which was the magazine that C.A. Stevens published virtually all of his stories in over a period of 60 years that he wrote for them. And as a circulation ploy, really, the Youth Companion in the 1880s and 90s, when there was a lot of saber rattling and imperialism going along and so on, the Youth Companion decided that the flag was a good thing to sell, and they managed to sell the flag in the school. It was one of their projects. They encourage kids to canvass the neighborhood to raise money to get flags in the school and to buy the flag from the Youth Companion magazine. And if you bought enough flags or magazines, you'd get free flags or magazines, whatever. As a result of that, in fact, flags appeared in virtually every schoolhouse in America, and then they apparently needed something to do with these flags. So one of the editors of the Youth Companion came up with a flag salute with some diagrams as to how to actually salute the flag and so on. Originally, it was saluted same as we now salute, but when the kids got to the end, with liberty and justice for all, they were supposed to go like this. That lasted for a few years. Didn't work after that. This was a hearty flag salute we had here this evening, and I'm just always reminded of that. The Under Guard part came with Dwight Eisenhower. And the other thing I want to note here is I heard mention of refreshments, which is always one of the things that drags me to these meetings. And I have to tell you that this past February, I sat at Greenwood at their meeting, and they had some dynamite refreshments there. So we will see. Now, the original topic, I set up a number of titles to stand for this talk. And the one that we actually were going to go with at the time was Sex, Lies, and C.A. Stevens. But he said that we'd have to wait until the society got in the new big building to accommodate the crowd that would turn up. So we will touch on some of those subjects in the course of the evening, but the actual talk that I will have to wait. I'm going to try to do three things this evening. One is just to give you a general overview of C.A. Stevens briefly. I think many of the people in the audience might be familiar with him and his work. But for the benefit of those who are not, I should give a little bit of background on C.A. Stevens himself. And then just a brief synopsis of his cousins. The primary topic of the talk this evening are the cousins of C.A. Stevens. The friends of C.A. Stevens have for the past couple of years been trying to find more information about these cousins. Who were they? The kids who showed up in the story that C.A. Stevens wrote. Were they real? Were they inventions? Were they half and half and so on? Who exactly were they? Where did they come from? Where did they go? What did they do? And then finally, I wanted to give you some more specific information about each of these six or seven cousins that I think you'll find quite interesting. I hope so, at any rate. C.A. Stevens, for those who are not familiar with him, was born in North Norway in 1844. Very soon thereafter moved to Bethel. Spent the first 4 or 5 years of his life up here in Bethel. His father was a minor, I don't know what official it was, a minor town official. But if somebody could like find out for us, please, what official that might have been, we'd be happy to know. Apparently, apparently, he decided that life back home was better shortly after 1850. 1851, probably, maybe 1852, the family moved back to their family farm in North Norway, where C.A. Stevens essentially spent the rest of his life there in Norway, North Norway, Norway Lake, and so on in that area. In 1868, Stevens went off to Kent's Hill Academy, where he spent a year preparing himself for Bowdoin College. He graduated from Bowdoin in 1869, so we've got to subtract 3 years, 66. It was 65 that he went off to Kent's Hill. Then he went to Bowdoin. He never actually graduated from Bowdoin. He was in the senior class. He got in a fight, apparently, with the administration over a graduation fee that he thought was unfair and he wasn't going to pay. And they said, fine, don't pay, don't graduate. later on, though, if you look at the alumni records of Bowdoin, as C.A. Stevens became more well-known, his name moved from the bottom part of the list where these were the students who had attended but not graduated. And over the years, he moved up into the official slots. And if you look at the current alumni records of Bowdoin College, you never know that he didn't graduate. As a matter of fact, he's declared here to be a graduate of the class of 69. Shortly after college, he went off to Boston. He spent just a week or so out in the West. He claimed he was going to go out there and chop wood for a living, but didn't find any trees, so came back. He went to work almost immediately in Boston writing stories, short stories for a number of magazines, and even a little bit of poetry, which we recently discovered, primarily for popular, what were called the Saturday night or Sunday magazines, the periodicals that came out Saturday, late Saturday, so people could read them on Sunday. Mostly throwaway stuff, and most of it's been thrown away. It's been very difficult to find these early pieces. In 1873 or 4, he submitted some stories to the Youth Companion that were accepted. He was offered more than he thought he should have for them. He then produced a bunch of other stories for the Youth Companion, and essentially then spent the rest of his professional career, 65 years, writing stories for the Youth Companion, 2,500 to 3,000 of them. And when he finally died, he still had hundreds of manuscripts that had not been published. Most of those were presently at Bowdoin. Many have been lost. The Youth Companion was bought and sold a number of times in its last few years, and the archives would be moved from one place to another. And in the course of that, many of these things did get lost. Bowdoin has, I think, 300 or 400 unpublished C.A. Stevens manuscripts presently. They haven't all been read, none of our projects. He also, in the course of his life, published a dozen books of short stories and another dozen science books, except one. They all had titles like, this is Natural Salvation, or Salvation by Science, that kind of title. It was essentially the same book written over and over again. You can see, if you start with the first one and go to the last, you can see the whole section taken up. But it's sometimes the same page number, so it'd be a long page. Well, in the course of his development as a writer, and his development as a writer was almost as slow as extremely well. He was paid to produce, and he did produce hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of stories week after week and month after month. And in, with that kind of production schedule, every Thursday that magazine came out, and virtually every Thursday it had one, sometimes two, C.A. Stevens stories. Hundreds of serials that would begin in one issue and run for 8 or 10 or 15, whatever. He was a prolific writer. The editors of the magazine were very interested in getting the magazine out to the public. They wanted to make sure that the magazine had the right moral tone, that it had the right mix of articles for the audience, some for older family members, some for younger, some for the parents, and so on. But they were not particularly concerned with what you and I might call internal art, you might call quality. They were not the, although they were eventually purchased by the Atlantic Monthly, they were not the Atlantic Monthly. They were basically a family weekly whose job it was to get out 16 or more pages of print every single week. As a result of that, C.A. Stevens did not enjoy the kind of editorial help that I think could have made him into a much better writer than he was. He did, however, develop over the years so that as those years went by, he realized that there were subjects that people were fascinated in, and those seemed to be subjects that he was able to master in this little short story format that he used so often. What he found around the turn of the century was that Americans, think about life in America at the turn of the century, this is 2 years after the sinking of the Maine, all kinds of war noise from Europe and around the world, a very dangerous time, a time when machines are essentially taking over, farms are dying, people are moving off farms into cities, and Americans at that time want to believe that's not what America's really like. That what America really is like is what it was like back before the Civil War, back before we fought with each other, back when we went out to the farm, went out to the farmhouse in the morning, we milked the cows, we went to the field, we came back. The largest adventures were possibly finding that one of the cows had disappeared and having to chase it down. Or finding that something had fallen into the well, first of all, let's figure out how to get it out. When we do get it out, my gosh, what is this thing anyhow? My uncle saw one once, maybe it's a badger. No, it's not a badger, it's a weasel. No, it's not a weasel, and so on. Those are simple times, and C.A. Stevens found that when he wrote about those times, the magazine sold. And when he put out a collection of those stories, those books sold. So from about 1900 on, Stevens wrote more and more about life on the farm in North Norway, Maine. The fundamental difference in his early stories and his later stories is that the early stories, for the most part, are taking place in the woods. Two 13-year-old boys chase down some animal, beat it to death, drag it back, they skin it and hang it on the barn. In the later stories, there are entire families, the cousins are there, there are girls, there are boys, the grandparents, and so on. They are warm, they're bucolic, they're simple, they are non-judgmental, they are non-religious, non-political, non-threatening. They're the stories about the kind of life that we all believe we should have been living all along. So they sold very well, and Stevens continued to write them. And he found that writing about these cousins of his was a very a profitable operation. This, by the way, is a this is from the Young Moose Hunters. This is his early, an example of his early stories. There they are. They're out in the woods. They're about to go after moose. They get them. They get the moose. They get, in the course of getting moose, they get blue herons and deer and every other conceivable kind of creature. They have a grand time. They go up to the McGalloway. They traipse around. They canoe and so on and so forth. So it's great. And this book was, in fact, Stevens's first and really largest bestseller probably of his entire career. This book sold over and over again, went through many, many editions. It followed six books that he wrote between 1872 and 74, which themselves were fairly popular and well publicized and made a lot of money for him. But this book really made a lot of money for him. And shortly after writing this book, as a matter of fact, he found that he had enough wherewithal to buy, to move off the farm, as people were not wanting to do, and to move down to Norway Lake, where he bought an existing farmhouse there and added a nice, attractive thing. This he was able to do because he was really rich. He had come into a lot of money. At this time, he owned his father's farm, which he had bought from his father up on the ridge, and he also owned this property down on the lake, a very nice property with lots of lake frontage. When this property was finally sold after his death, it was divided in half right along the road that goes through Norway Lake there, and everything on the lake side eventually ended up with the town. Interesting, the last piece of that property ended up with the town just last year. The estate had it, then it came back to the town. And the property on the right-hand side, after his death, changed hands several times. Presently, there's a nice house there, but this building is gone. At the back, I brought in from the Norway Historical Society a collection of photographs, which were put together by Sid Gordon, who was here last month, and donated to the Historical Society. These are very unusual and rare pictures from the inside of this building, which Stevens called the laboratory, where he did his looking through the microscope. You can see over here, there's another barn. This is kind of across the driveway. And eventually, his wife, Christine, set up shop over there. Stevens lived here. She lived across the road. They essentially had separate houses here on the same lot. Let's see. Here is the family at about the time that they were being quite successful here in town. Here's C.A. Stevens and his wife Christine shortly after they were married. And their children that look to be about, what, 5 and 6 or something like that. So the children were born in 1874 and 1877. So these were probably right around 1880. The young moose hunters had come out in the late 70s, and his other 6 big sons were out in the early 70s. So at this time, the family is doing quite well. As the years went on, Stevens, because he was a bit on the wacky side, as you could say, kept adding to this building, adding, and he'd come back from a trip, and he didn't like the cupola the way it was, let's do it a different way. And you can see some of the pictures back there. The one in the upper left-hand corner has a very interesting cupola, and Sid has it labeled the laboratory before any additions. But when you look at that later on, if you compare this to that one, and then that one to this one, they're all different. The cupola itself is on the side of the road there on 118 at Norway, just across from where the laboratory stood. Excuse me, on the same side, just up a little bit, there's a very low building made of cinder blocks, and stuck on the end is something that looks like, kind of like that, that's all poured over and so on. It's not, you wouldn't know it unless you were really looking for it. Pardon me? That's exactly right. Yeah, it was the town took it over on taxes a couple of years ago. So Stevens is doing quite well, and one of the reasons he's doing quite well is that he's discovering that people like to read these kinds of stories. Now, in 1885, which is the year in which he put together this first set of buildings down on the lake, it's also the year that he began medical school. It's also the year that in the Youth's Companion, in May of that year, he published a story called Grandfather's Stories While Picking Over Beans. It's a little story that involves the kids on the farm, the cousins. There's Theodora, there's George. There's the author himself, he often called himself Kit. They have been instructed to hoe the peas as the grandparents were going off to town. The grandparents are always going off to town to do something. Every time they go off to town, the kids get into trouble, the grandparents go back. The grandparents have come back and found that the peas, having not been properly hoed, were they strangled? Did the frost hit them? Something happened to these peas. Very few were left, and as a punishment, the children are required to shell them all. It's their job, and so they'll have a real appreciation for what's happened here. They can see these terrible things. They have to throw away so many of them. But in the meantime, the grandfather agrees to tell them some stories as they're sitting there. And in a serial that ran for 4 weeks in the Youth Companion, he tells four different stories. The stories don't have really anything to do with, one of them has something to do with the farm, but the other three have to do with the French and Indian War, the Machias, and a few other odd kinds of things. But it's a formula that Stevens probably just stumbled into in that story. And it's a formula that he forgot for a number of years. It's here's a story that when we look back, we can say, oh, that's the first Old Squire story. But then when you try to find the second Old Squire story, it's 15 years later, where you find the same cousins coming together in the grandfather's house and so on. And it's not until the turn of the century, in the early 1900s, that you find that Stevens is beginning to invent the reason that the cousins are there. The reason that the cousins are there is that their fathers have all been killed in the Civil War. And at that time, when your father is dead, there's no income. You need to find a place to live. So the mothers of these children end up staying with some relatives in Philadelphia, wherever they're from. And the children are all brought back to the grandparents' farm. These are the parents of the sons. There are five sons who were supposedly killed in the Civil War. These are their children. They come back. Now, Stevens had the story, had the basic idea in 1885, but it really wasn't until the turn of the century that he realized that this is something that's going to work. But in order to make it work, we've got to put the pieces together. We've got to make it so that it will become compelling. And week after week, people want to tune in to find out, well, what did Halstead do this week to get into trouble? And, you know, how did Theodora solve the problem between the grandmother and so-and-so when something went wrong? Because Theodora's always solving the problem. And how did Addison figure out how to get out of this mess? Because it's always Addison who comes up with the brilliant schemes and ideas as how to get out of these things. And he gave to each of these characters a personality and played those personalities over and over again for the next 25 years, from 1900 up until really the time that he died. And it wasn't until 1912, as a matter of fact, which was really just, he died in 1931, and he was younger in 1929, so it's really only another 13 years. He's now been writing for 40 or 50 years. At the tail end of his career, in 1912, when he put out the book, the first Old Squire book called When Life Was Young. Now that book was a success. It was such a success, he put out the first one himself, but it was such a success that the Youth Companion then started putting it out and using it as a premium to get subscriptions. And very shortly thereafter came four or five other Old Squire books. In that first book, When Life Was Young, Stevens has the story all put together. Here we are at Lake Pennesawassee. Here's a picture of the lake. Here is a map of the farm. If you open up, if you find one of the early editions, there's a map of the farm in there. The first story, which is called A Nose in Common, because all these children have the same nose because they have the same parentage. A little story about how the children came to be on the farm. And the last one to arrive is Kit himself, who arrives on the train and he's greeted by the others. And then in the course of the next year, he has to learn how the farm works. All the other cousins have been there a year before him. So it's really a neat scheme to get these stories put together. Now, if you're familiar with the Youth Companion, as you read these stories, you say, oh, this one was in the Youth Companion 20 years ago with some slightly different characters, but you rearranged them and plugged it in. As you read that book, you get a real sense that here's a family, it's really happening, these were real kids, they really did lose their parents, they all have unique personalities. There's such detail here that these must be true, must really be true, these really must be real people, this must be a real a farm family. There's got to be an Old Squire, there's got to be an Old Squire's farm. There's got to be a Theodora, a Halstead, an Addison, an Ellen, a wealthy poor girl who died so young, etc. And what began happening almost immediately was the readers of the Youth Companion of these books, began writing and coming to Norway to see the Old Squire's farm, see if the Old Squire is still there, and where did he live, and where are these cousins, and so on. And they stopped at C.H. Stevens' house, they wrote to him. We have very little of his actual correspondence as a result of the the destruction of the laboratory and most of the things that were being thrown out or lost. Another large number of them were preserved by Louise Harris, who was a very avid C.A. Stevens collector. But unfortunately, when Louise Harris died, those things disappeared. Many of the items in Louise Harris's collection ended up at Brown University. Many hundreds and hundreds of books, C.A. Stevens books, books from the laboratory itself, textbooks that he had used when he was in college. But the one set of things that did not appear after her death for Brown University were the letters to and from C.A. Stevens that we know she had, because in her books there are photocopies of them. They disappeared as well. So most of the important things that we'd like to find from C.A. Stevens are gone. 5 years ago, when I first became involved in the Friends of C.A. Stevens, I made it a point to try to find all the letters of his, like the copies of them. Whenever I go into a library or museum, I check to see if they might have some stray letter of C.A. Stevens's. And in 5 years, I found 6 letters. You know, there's one at the American Antiquarian Society, there's one at the Boston Public Library, there's one at the Massachusetts Historical Society, there's one at the Maine Historical Society, etc. A few others have appeared, but it's a real shame that this person, who obviously wrote letters every single day, they're all gone. But it's interesting that a couple of letters that do survive are C.A. Stevens in 1921 writing a letter to a gentleman who was obviously written to him, saying, thank you for your nice letter. Yes, it's very nice up here in the farmland where I live. To tell you the truth, Halstead was always getting into trouble, as you know, and he would come and go, and we eventually lost track of him, and right now we don't know where he is. We haven't heard from him in years. Now, 2 years after that, J. Stevens wrote a serial, it was a 10-part serial for the Youth Companion, called The Squire's Grandson, The Old Squire's Grandson, The Old Squire's Great-Grandson, which is a very detailed story of exactly what happened to Halstead. From leaving the farm, he went out to Texas, he got into trouble there, he eventually got married, he married a German, a young German immigrant. He became a stonecutter, a very artistic stonecutter, because he had, his mother, you see, had been Spanish. His father was a sailor and had run into his mother down in New Orleans someplace. So he married this Spanish woman, and we all know that if you got some Spanish blood in you, you've got to be, you know, hot-blooded and probably artistic and so on, which is what Halstead was. But all kinds of detail, exactly the town he went to was New Braunfels, Texas, the name of the family that he married into, the fact that Theodora went to visit him, the fact that he then came back to the farm for a Thanksgiving later on, all kinds of detail. Now, I suspect that the letter that C.A. Stevens wrote in 1921 is, in fact, the truth, that he has no clue as to what happened to Halstead. As a matter of fact, his name wasn't Halstead, it was George, and he disappeared. And I think that's true. And I think that the fact that 2 years later he had this 10-part serial in the Youth Companion has to do with the fact that when you've got to fill up the Youth Companion every single week with story after story after story, and you've got people writing to you saying, hey, whatever happened to Halstead? Well, answer the question. Sell 10 stories and they're all free. I have here, I'm going to get too complex about this whole thing. That's about the thing. Now, that's very hard to read, and I know it would be. So, I have. I don't know if there'll be enough of these to go around, but I made a bunch of copies of these. As a matter of fact, this one has some information on it, but that one doesn't. So I will hand these out first. Appreciate your assistance here circulating this. Now, this is my attempt to create a family tree for the old squire and the cousins, the old squire's neighborhood. And a lot of this is absolutely true. Somebody at a Chamber of Commerce meeting once, I remember saying, it's well known that half of advertising works. The problem is nobody knows which half. Well, it's the same with this. Half of this is true. Let's take and figure out which half. Yours you'll find numbers. I've numbered the generations, which I should have done on this one. First generation, second generation, third generation, fourth generation. These families across the top are the very earliest settlers in Norway and North Norway. You probably recognize those names, and a lot of those folks came from this area and moved back and forth, and there's lots of overlap and so on. the Nobles of Nobles Corner, the Hobsons, there are Hobsons everywhere. I've learned of the five initial settlers in Norway, four of them were either Hobsons or married to Hobsons. Stevens, three of the five were Stevenses, Upton, Cordwell, and Verrill. Now, later on this year, in November, Herb Adams will be up here talking specifically about this line of the family. Herb and I have spent almost a year now trying to assemble information about Addison. Last year, we spent scouting on Theodora. This year, Herb's going to deal with Addison this year, and I was going to try to figure out who Ellen was. We'll talk about Ellen a little later. Now, these people are real people. Samuel Verrill was a very early settler in Greenwood. His son Daniel had a very nice farm over there. The foundation still exists. A bunch of us went up there last week to sort of tramp around it. George Washington Verrill was a grocer and a general store operator in Lock Mills and Bethel and eventually in Portland. And his son Addison is the Addison of these stories. The Addison of these stories. In some of the later stories, we find, in fact, that his last name is Verrill. But from the very earliest C.A. Stevens stories, there's a character named Addison. He's a science student. He went to Harvard. These are from the very earliest stories, the first ones that came out. In the first of all the stories having to do with Addison, he's called Wash, probably after his father. There were lots of Washes, George Washington's at the time. But in the very earliest stories, the Camping Out books, there's this character named Wash. He's a student at Harvard, as Addison was. He goes off on scientific expeditions with famous scientists, as Addison did. Then as the stories progress, we eventually learn that he's very interested in geology, as Addison was, that he discovers interesting minerals in this area, which Addison did, that he eventually goes off to college, becomes a professor, works as a mineralogist for mining companies and so on. All of this is absolutely true. It absolutely matches Addison. It matches his personality, his character, the kind of person that he must have been. And tune in on this coming November and you'll find out a lot more about Addison. He was a fascinating person. And true. And here he is in C.A. Stevens' stories. From the very earliest ones, there's an Addison who's interested in science. He's curious. He's skeptical. He's creative. And it's Addison, absolutely. It's the Addison Verrill who grew up on the other side of Patch Mountain and whose house foundation is still there. No question about it. The next oldest of these cousins was George. Now, in the early C.A. Stevens stories, there is, in fact, this cousin George who shows up, whose personality is hard to pin down. In some stories, he's a central character. In other, he's a peripheral sort of person. Gradually, as the years go by, George becomes more and more troublesome. He starts walking in his sleep. He starts doing the chores that he's supposed to do. The kids are chopping wood, and they're supposed to put marks on the however many cords they chop, and he's fudging his marks and so on. Eventually, though, his name changes to Halstead, and we suspect the reason the name changes to Halstead, we can't find any Halsteads anywhere in the area, and that's the reason that his name changes to Halstead, because it's okay to have Addison keep his name throughout, because Addison is a good boy, he's a hardworking boy, he's a smart boy. George is a troublemaker, and I suspect that George Upton, who we think was the Halstead, whose father, in fact, did spend some time on the ocean, but he did not marry a Spanish woman, in fact, married a local woman. But we suspect that because C.A. Stevens was taking such liberties with his character and making him the troublemaker, that he thought it might be prudent to give him a name that wasn't going to get anybody into trouble, either George himself or C.A. Stevens. So George, over the course of time, becomes Halstead. Here's C.A. Stevens himself, the child of an Upton and a Stevens. He's the character who's he's always the narrator. His name, generally speaking, is Kit. Sometimes he calls himself Nicholas. More often than not, though, in 90% of his stories, he has no name at all. He's simply this narrator who's back far enough so that he stays entirely out of the action and just watches what goes on. This is a fascinating cousin, Christine. Christine Stevens, in fact, was C.A. Stevens' cousin. They were next door neighbors. Christine was born in North Norway as well. The family lived in Greenwood, but they moved just over the line just before she was born. And when Christine was growing up, when they were about 5 years old, they were lived across the street from each other, and they grew up across the street from each other. They eventually married. Now, we're convinced that in the C.A. Stevens stories, whenever we run into Catherine Edwards, yours has a C, which is right, mine has a K, which is wrong. Whenever you run into Catherine Edwards, that's Christine. And the reason we think that that's true is that in the camping out books, Fox Hunting in particular, which is a book very few people get to, if you read that, it's a series of six books that came out one right after another, just a couple of months apart in 1872, 3, and 4. Camping Out has to do with these four explorers who go off to Katahdin. And then Left on Labrador, they go up to the subarctic in Canada and do some more exploring. And then they go off to the geysers, which they go to Iceland and they do some other exploring. And I challenge anyone in this room or anyone on this planet to read Off to the Geysers and then want to read the next book in the series. Because it's a terrible book. Oh, it's awful. It's dreadful. What it is at the time that Stevens was writing, Norse mythology was becoming popular. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow had become the professor of German at Bowdoin. He was the first professor of German anywhere. Up until that time, as a matter of fact, foreign languages weren't studied in America. When you speak English, you read the Bible, that's it. That's all you need to know. You go to college because you're going to be a preacher. That's it. But about the time that C.A. Stevens was in school, as a matter of fact, the very year that C.A. Stevens was a senior, Bowdoin began its scientific school and divided the college into science students and ministers, or science students and all others. And most other colleges at the time did the same thing. Harvard started its Lawrence Science Institute that was headed by Louis Agassiz, who in fact became Addison's teacher. Addison was the first director of the Lawrence Museum, which Louis Agassiz had put together. So in colleges at the time, people are beginning to study things. One of the things they're studying are languages, and one of the things they're studying are things like new science, whole new fields like archaeology, history as a subject. Up until that time, there was really no history as a subject. There was life. And the subjects were grammar and the Bible and astronomy and mathematics and so on. But at that time, one of the things people were interested in were their roots, their history, and because a lot of Americans were Northern European, there was an intense interest in Scandinavian things. Wagner was off writing the Ring Cycle and all that kind of stuff. And these Norse legends and these Icelandic sagas and so on, all this stuff was really hot. Well, C.A. Stevens wrote Off to the Geysers, and he's got two or three chapters in there about getting to Iceland, arranging with the locals to get some ponies, taking the ponies up into the hills, and then, in about chapter four, they arrive at one of these Icelandic farmers' houses, and from then on, it's Icelandic saga that the old farmer tells them. And Icelandic sagas are interesting for a paragraph or two, but nowadays, we don't read them, we don't like them. They are deadly dull, unless you're an Icelander. So the next book that came out after that was Fox Hunting. Now, Fox Hunting is an entirely different kind of book. It's so different, as a matter of fact, that when the Youth Companion put out that series, that Camping Out series, as a premium gift, instead of having six volumes, as the series actually does, the Youth Companion version has only five volumes. They dropped out Fox Hunting because Fox Hunting is a story in which C.A. Stevens gets kissed. You know, it happens right there in the last chapter. It's actually quite a good, it's a great book. The Fox Hunting book is, I think, of those six, it's far and away the best because it's got male and female characters. It's got them doing something other than clubbing animals or climbing. Katahdin's fun to climb, but after you climb the Ziskahas and every other mountain in the state, you want to read about something different. And Fox Hunting was distinctly different from all those other books. It essentially involves these four lads transferred over in Portland, where they have to study up for the final exams they have coming. So there they are in Portland, and the choice is to study or to, as Kit says, hey, wait a second. My grandparents live not far from here. They've got a great place. Let's go up there and spend the winter up there in Norway. So the four lads come to Norway to spend the winter fox hunting, as they say. But they don't do a lot of fox hunting. They do a lot of skating on the lake with the girls. The girls are terrific. They can out-skate all the boys. There's some very interesting, about chapter 3 or 4, there's some very interesting feminist scenes. The boys have decided that because college is deadly dull, they will have this scheme to go around the world on what they call the steamship college, and they will learn by doing. They will not sit in stuffy old classrooms. They will get out and exercise their muscles. And the Catherine Edwards, who is the central character in Fox Hunting, as she's skating out on the lake with one of these guys, not Kit, one of the other young scientists, says, wait a second, I'm going to Westbrook College right now myself. Nothing could be worse than that. It's terrible. Why can't I go on this around the world expedition thing? And the young lad said, well, you know, you're a girl, and there's a lot of hard, heavy lifting and so on. She basically says, you want to skate me and see who's stronger here? It's actually quite interesting. There's a lot of back and forth and so on. Eventually what happens at the end of that book is that each of these three boys in turn falls madly in love with Kate. Because Kate, if you read this book, she is just astonishingly attractive. And what's more, she's healthy and she's strong and she's American and all these other great things. C.A. Stevens spends a lot of time talking about how much better these American girls are than these would-be European girls. Here's a much later photograph that is labeled as Catherine when 17. And if you remember, we're convinced that Catherine is in fact Christine. Now let me put this one back here, see if we can get them to show up together. I think you can see those are not the same people by a long shot. Not even close. Now the reason we're convinced that the Catherine character is Christine is that this book came out in 1872, the very year that C.A. Stevens was married. This series was his first big set of books. Here's this character, Catherine Edwards, who all these boys one at a time fall head over heels with, but she's happy to skate with them, to walk with them, to talk with them, to argue with them, but she breaks their hearts. And at the very end of the story, as the grandparents are away, once again, those silly grandparents are always leaving, and the kids are using the house to play hide-and-seek in, it turns out that one of the lads hides in the trunk in the attic, and unbeknownst to Kit, the author, and Catherine Edwards, who also hide in the attic on the other side of the trunk, and where they say, Kit says, you fooled them all, Catherine. And she said, well, I had to, Kit, because you're the one I love. And then, I challenge anyone to tell me that in 1872, the year that C.A. Stevens is marrying this person, that this ravishing girl who lives right across the road from the author and has promised to be true while he's off to college and so on, and now he's come back, and they've got just another year or so, and then they're going to get married. The pattern is perfect, really, for Catherine Edwards being Christine. I think it had to be. However, when C.A. Stevens published When Light Was Young in 1912, things had changed. He had all kinds of great Catherine Edwards stories. And I have to tell you that if you read these stories, Catherine becomes a more and more interesting character as the stories go along. She's really quite an interesting young woman, and well worth the many stories that he wrote about her. Now, in 1912, when this book was published, C.A. Stevens was marrying somebody else, I'm afraid to say. He was marrying Minnie Sklar, who was an opera singer, who had been singing in Europe and had become pretty well known, and was ending her career, came back to Norway. And as Herb Adams realized in putting the calendars together, that as Christine, 2 days before Christine died, as she was not a healthy woman in her later years, as she's obviously lying on her deathbed, train coming into town, and probably from Norway Lake, Christine heard that whistle. This is Herb Adams's. Tune in November to hear it, because he's always coming out with interesting things like this. But I suspect he's right. 2 days before Christine died, she probably didn't realize that the train whistle that she heard coming into Norway had on it Madame Scholar returning to Norway for the first time in many years from her successful American tour and previous to that, a successful singing career in Europe. Christine died, and less than a year later, C.A. Stevens married Minnie Scholar. He married her in 1912. This book came out in 1912. Well, here's a dilemma for C.A. Stevens. He's got all these great Catherine Edwards stories. They're clearly stories about Christine, but he's been estranged from Christine for 10, 15 years now. And he knows that when this book comes out, it came out in 1912, so the editors had to be putting it together in 1911, the year that Christine died. So, put yourself in C.A. Stevens' place. The book is coming out. It's got great stories in it. It's got Catherine Edwards stories in it. It's got pictures of the various cousins, including a picture of the girl next door, Catherine Edwards. But do you think that C.A. Stevens either could have, or if he could, would he want to put a picture of Christine in there, that this is Catherine Edwards? That's not going to work, as my granddaughter said. This isn't going to work. So I don't know where he came up with this picture. We have no idea who this woman is. She fits the description of Catherine in terms of being dark-haired. He often mentions her dark hair. But aside from that, it's clearly not Christine Stevens, and we do not know who it is. We expect that somewhere in some graduation collection somewhere, some college or high school in Maine from the late 1800s, someone's going to come across this picture. And it will be, who knows who it will be. We want to know. Also, just in passing, C.A. Stevens wrote another book, another series of the Youth Companion, and brought it out as a book called Molly's Baby, subtitled The Little Heroine of the Sea, involved a little girl who, Addison goes up to Hudson's Bay, where he rescues this daughter of a trapper who, the trapper I think has been killed by the Eskimos, and the mother's there and she's dying. Addison brings back this little baby back to the farm, where the baby is Molly. Molly is brought back, where she is raised. Molly's the wife up on Hudson's Bay who doesn't make it back. The baby is rescued by Addison, brought back to the farm. Then she goes out and stays for a time with Ellen, who's out in Dakota now. And then she goes on to California, where she's adopted by a family that takes her out to sea by a sea captain. And out there, her father breaks his leg. He falls in the mast or something. And she, who's now 15 or 16, has to navigate the ship back and does so successfully. So it's a great story. Now, C.A. Stevens, in that book, has a picture of Molly as a child. There she is. It says, "The little snowbird, when in her sixth year, Molly was called the snowbird." Okay, now if you've got a copy of Molly's Baby, that's the story that's in it. And I will put this back up here, the same thing that you're doing. So I ask you, who is Molly's Baby?
Yeah.
Molly's Baby is Edna, right? Clearly, it's a daughter. It's the same picture. It's the same dress, the same. You just cut it differently, and there it is, Molly's Baby. So we know who Molly's Baby is. Here is the picture in that same book, the 1912 issue of When Life Was Young of Addison. Oops. There we go. Addison was about 18. There he is. Here is from the Verrill family genealogy. Here's Addison, Professor Addison E. Verrill, at that time, 1839-1926. Died in Hawaii. It's interesting because the ship that Molly saved managed to make it safely to Hawaii. Here is Theodora. This is Theodora, when about 19. This is, in fact, a picture of Theodora. We have a photograph, a clearly identified photograph of Theodora from the Lewiston Journal, taken, it appeared in 1904. It was Theodora having come back from the West, where she was a teacher of Indians on some Indian reservations. Missionaries And there's a picture of her there as a woman in her late 60s or early 70s possibly at the time. Obviously many years different from this, but it's clearly the same woman, same facial structure, same cheek, same chin, and so on. That's Theodora. So we're pretty sure that this probably is indeed Theodora. Now Theodora, where's our chart? Problem with the overheads, you keep losing your slide. Here we go. Okay. So, here's Addison, George, C.A. Stevens, Christine. Here's Theodora. Theodora was also a Greenwood girl. She grew up on a house that still stands down on Richardson Hollow Road. The Dursteins owned it for 10 years and just sold last year, the year before, to the family that's there now. They live in Yarmouth. Forget their name. It's a lovely house. It's right on the turn. If you come up from North Norway to the Greenwood Road and take a right, the road rises and then kind of sweeps off to the right and then turns back to the left. Right on that turn is this house. And from there, you can imagine when the trees are down, and in the fall you can see this view. There's a spectacular view down Pennsylvania. And also, interestingly, Theodora lived there until 1855 when her family went off to Lewiston. Her father was a mechanic and apparently got a job in a factory there in Lewiston. They moved to Lewiston in 1855, which was, I can't tell you all these details, just too many of them. The father had an arrangement with Mary Jane, who's married to John G. Robinson. I put that name on your chart. Mary Jane Stevens. Her father, Daniel, was getting old, and as in many of these cases, needed someone to make sure the farm would run. He made an agreement, it's on record down at the Registry of Deeds in Paris, with John G. Robinson. And John G. Robinson would maintain the farm, take care of the unmarried daughter, and so on and so forth, in exchange for which, when the father died, the farm would be his. Now, the father and the mother, both grandparents, Daniel and his wife Miriam, died in 1855 within about a month of each other. And within a month of that, the Robinson family moved to Lewiston. The interesting thing is that John G. Robinson sold the farm about 5 years earlier, probably unbeknownst to the grandparents, and then rented it back. He sold it to one of many land developers down there. As a matter of fact, he sold it to one of the Noises. But at any rate, he didn't own the farm, and I suspect that the grandfather didn't know that. But within really weeks of the grandparents dying, they were out of there. They went to Lewiston. From there, they went to Springfield, Illinois, where Theodora went to high school and graduated finally. She started at Lewiston High School, graduated from Springfield, Illinois High School. Then they moved to Kansas, town of Ottawa, Kansas, where Theodora met and married George B. Jeunesse. George Benning Jeunesse, whose parents were from New Hampshire originally. So Theodora now finds herself in Kansas, and her name is Jeunesse, and the fellow that she's married to is just an astonishing scoundrel who manages to lose job after job, lose house after house, squander money after money. Finally, he left Theodora and their two daughters, just took off one day and never appeared again. Vanished, stranding her in Fort Scott, Kansas, with the ability to teach. She had been a teacher. She'd also been writing stories. And, matter of fact, this is the book we put out last year, which is a collection of, this is Theodora, this is Christine. This is a collection of stories by Theodora and Christine. Most of Theodora's stories are set in Kansas, some in Minnesota, but out west where she spent the rest of her life. And most of Christine's are set right here in Norway here. So Theodora's husband left her, and at that time, then in fact, Theodora did go to work at the Episcopal Mission School at the Standing Rock Reservation in South Dakota. Off and on then, for the next 15 years, she taught at that school, and then she would return from time to time to her daughters, who was living and teaching in New York City at the time in Brooklyn. Theodora eventually died in Brooklyn, and she's presently buried in Greenwood Cemetery in Brooklyn, which I find. Now, Theodora, you see, isn't fact a real character. That's her name, Theodora. I don't think C.A. Stevens could have made that up. And what C.A. Stevens tells us about Theodora is that she went to Kent's Hill, which she didn't. C.A. Stevens went to Kent's Hill. She then went off as a single woman, never mentions her being married, to teach Indians in South Dakota. And he even says, as a matter of fact, that she taught Indians at St. John, at the St. John Reservation in South Dakota, which is exactly what she did. After 20 years of a disastrous marriage to a drunken lout, we never hear that to C.A. Stevens, however. Now, the first time that we see Theodora in any of the stories is that Grandfather Peniel Ramin's story in 1885. By 1885, Theodora had been publishing her first stories, and she was doing fairly well. Her husband didn't leave her until 1892. So at that time, C.A. Stevens mentioned Theodora, but he didn't get back really to including Theodora seriously in his stories until 1908, 9, 10, 11, in there. By that time, her life had fallen apart. She had really had a very difficult time of it, and she did, in fact, end up teaching on the Indian reservation. But what C.A. Stevens tells us about Christine is the truth about her beginning. She was from this area, etc. And he tells us the truth, sort of, about her end. She taught Indians and so on. But he doesn't tell us the gory details, her marriage, her children, the fact that she was a writer, I find interesting. If you read the story called Tom's Fort, where these kids, this story is written in 1920s. The kids are standing around, they've had a picnic, and the fire's going down, and they're sitting there, and they're talking about what it is they want to do when they grow up. And Addison says, well, I want to go off and be a scientist in this world, which of course he's already a scientist, so it's a big secret. And the kids are talking about this and that, and so on and so forth. And Theodora says, well, I do have an ambition, and I do have a goal, she said, but it's a very difficult one, and I don't think I should talk about it here. It's a perfect spot for him, for Stevens to say, because he has no other writers in any of his stories. I mean, he's a writer, of course, but he characterizes himself as a farmer. To say, I would like to write stories for children. It wouldn't fit, but he doesn't tell us that. So he tells us the whole truth about Addison. Who knows what about this guy? Catherine Edwards, he tells us very interesting things about her, which I'm convinced are true early on, and then she just becomes sort of a magical figure as time goes on. Theodora, we get the truth about the beginning and the truth about the end, but we don't get any of the, what comes from in between. Finally, I will just, in passing, mention, yes, the first big thing that Stevens wrote was a 24-part, two-year serial for a magazine called Blues in Boston. You've probably seen copies of Blues. They have it was a competitor to Harper's, and so they have these nice pictures on the front sometimes of historical things that people collect. C.A. Stevens, in the children's section of Blues, wrote a series of stories called Guess, or The Son of a Politician. It involves a young man from this area who goes off to first Lewiston, and then over there, not finding any employment, decides, well, I might as well join the army. He joins the army. He becomes a drummer in a main regiment that goes off to Ship Island, involved in the Battle of New Orleans, eventually ends up in Georgia, and then he comes back to Maine, and so on and so forth. And it goes on. It has lots of interesting things in it that C.A. Stevens never wrote about after that. The Civil War is one. Actual Parents is another one. It's got a love theme, which he seldom wrote about, and has some very interesting local scenes, including a scene where these two guys basically break into the Shaker Village, tie up a couple of the elderses there, and run off with one of the pretty young girls. it turns out that Stevens's cousin, who was almost an exact contemporary of his, Francis Noble, who was the youngest child of Nathan Jr., was in fact a drummer in the 14th Maine, did go to Ship Island, was involved in the Battle of New Orleans, did then end up in Georgia, where his regiment was decommissioned, came back to Maine. We haven't yet tracked him down to find out what he did after that, but it seems to me that correspondence of things going on is close enough so that I think it's a pretty fair, shall we say, a pretty fair guess that that this, in fact, was the main character in that book, or at least a lot of the details, the historical details, are based on that. Okay, now, last but not least, we've been looking for Ellen. We've been trying to find her. C.A. Stevens tells us that Ellen, who was the first of the cousins to arrive, had a sister named Wealthy. Poor Wealthy died of cholera. She died of diphtheria. She died of diphtheria when the water in the schoolhouse well went bad because evil Mr. Tibbetts, who controlled the school board at the time, wouldn't put the money in cleaning it up. Wealthy, I think, was 6 or 7 when she died. That was Ellen's sister. Ellen then herself fell in love with a school teacher called Thomas Jefferson Cobb, who drowned in the Kennebec. Ellen then married a fellow named Masterson. She had 3 sons whose names were Jesse, Quimby with an N, and Welcome, which are fairly unusual names, at least the Quimby with an N and Welcome. And then she went off to Dakota, where she lived until Masterson died. After that, she went to the Peace River Valley in Alberta, Canada, where she and her sons operated a farm, and that's the last we hear of Ellen. She did come back, according to C.A. Stevens, for this memorable Thanksgiving dinner, where the kids assembled back at the farm. Now, those are very clear, very specific details, and that one detail that Ellen lived in North Dakota until 1906, when her husband died, that her sons were named Jesse, Quimby, and Welcome, that's in the very same paragraph that says that Theodora went to South Dakota, where she taught the Indians on the St. John Mission School. Those are actual facts. The Theodora facts are verified facts that we know for sure actually happened. So if those facts are true, it seems reasonable that the Ellen facts might also be true. That there she would have been in 1906, living in North Dakota with 3 sons named Jesse, Quimby, and Welcome, and her last name would be Masterson, and her first name would be Ellen. Well, I have to tell you, I spent the last 2 months reading the North Dakota census for 1900. And I found that there were 186 women there who were born in Maine, but were living at the time in North Dakota. There were a number of them. There were 6 or 7 Ellens. There was not one of them was named Masterson, I'm afraid to say. Not one had 3 sons named Jesse, Quimby, and Welcome.
Oh.
No. There were women from Maine who had 3 sons, you know, Fred and George and Bill. There were women named Ellen who were unmarried. There were, you know, there were all kinds of combinations of things, but there was no combination that looked remotely like the Ellen that we're looking for, unfortunately. The Canadians run their censuses in the 5 years as opposed to the 0 years, 5, 15, and so on. So we'll try for Alberta to see if we can find her up there. One of the interesting facts about Ellen is that C.A. Stevens gives us those very clear details, which hook us, you see, it's got to be true. Now, Quimby with an N, I thought Quimby with an N is an interesting name, or just to say a word about her sister, Wealthy, who died. Well, in Norway history, in the genealogies of Norway, every single Wealthy is a Hobbes, every one of them. So you'd say, aha, she's a Hobbes. And if they're sisters, well, maybe Ellen's a Hobbes as well. And in fact, there are a number of Ellens, Mary Ellens, Mark Ellens, and so on, that are Hobbes. There's one very interesting Hobbes, as a matter of fact. You have it on your chart. It's not on this chart. There was a William Hobbes, son of Jeremiah, brother of Olive, who had a son named William, who had a daughter named Martha Ellen. Now, Martha Ellen was born in 1844. And according to the Norway histories, Martha Ellen married a fellow named Alvin Wilcox and went to Dakota.
Oh.
There's an interesting lead. Now, another fascinating lead is that her father, William, was one of the 49ers who left Norway and went to California in 1849 to prospect for gold. He was relatively successful in Norway, and I think the people were surprised that he left because he had a going farm and so on and so forth. His wife at the time was 31 years old. He had, I believe, 4 children. He had 4 children because his youngest daughter, who was going to die 2 years later of cholera, getting together, eh? So those 4 children were alive. The second youngest was Martha Ellen. He went off to California to dig for gold. And he went along with another very respected member of the North Norway community. He went with Reverend, what is his first name? I'm sorry. Reverend something Quinby, with an M. I think it's interesting. And what's more interesting is that when Reverend Quinby went off to California, William Whitman Hobbs and Reverend Quinby together put together this group from Norway that was going to, they were the leaders, they were going to go off and dig gold. They left their families behind. Now the interesting thing about Reverend Quinby is that his wife was 31 years old, lived not more from the census. You know, if you read the census, you can tell that the census taker goes along the road, and so if you get the families that are close to each other, you know, you can tell where the neighborhoods are. Well, the Quinby family lived not more than two or three houses away from the Whitman Hobbs family. Both of the wives are the same age. They both have children who are of this, roughly the same age. Their husbands have gone together out to California, and Whitman Hobbs, William Whitman Hobbs, eventually leaves California because, surprise, surprise, he doesn't get rich. He comes back to Minnesota to do farming, and the last that I've been able to find with regard to him is that he was living in western Minnesota at the end of his life, which is awfully close to North Dakota, sadly. So, you know, I think we may have found Ellen. I think she may be Martha Ellen Hobbs, but there's still enough unknown so that we're not quite sure. But then the real question is this, and we're getting to the end of our talk here. The real question is this one. Who cares? Writers make things up, and when C.A. Stevens puts a picture of Captain Edwards in his book, it's a lie, it's not true at all. And when he tells us that Theodora, you know, when he leaves out the stuff in the middle, and when he writes back to this fellow, he's either lying when he says he doesn't know anything about Halsted, or he's lying when he wrote the stories about Halsted, one or the other, and he's lying. And we would say, well, who cares about this? Well, I had a call this morning from a fellow from Richmond, Virginia, who happened to have, when he was growing up, he was from North New Portland, Maine, and happened to grow up in Belmont, Massachusetts, and his next-door neighbor was Edna Stevens, Edna Stevens Delano, who was C.A. Stevens' daughter. And his mother had, because she knew that he was interested in the Stevenses, his mother had run across a copy of Reverend Whitney's book, The World of C.A. Stevens, and had given it to him recently. He was reading in the book, and he read the part about Edna, and this book implies that C.A. Stevens' children were a bit ungrateful, and that they didn't really get along with their father, etc. And he called up from Richmond, Virginia. He got our name on the Bethel Historical Society internet site, because he was searching for C.A. Stevens and found this talk coming up tonight. Got my name. And he said that he was annoyed that Reverend Whitney had said these nasty things about Edna. Edna was a wonderful woman. She was gracious, friendly, sweet, thoughtful, helpful, everything. He said, Edna Delano was one of the most important people in my life, he said, when I was growing up. She was a wonderful person. She told me stories, next door neighbor, she told me stories. I took care of her dog, and so on and so forth. And what he said, we're talking along, he happens to be exactly the same age that I am. He's interested, it turns out. As a matter of fact, one of the things he noticed, and he had a copy of the original Reverend Whitney book. This is a reprint that we did last year. And we have a picture here of Madame Sklar, which is really Madame Sklar. But in the original book, it's not Madame Sklar, it's Nordica. This fellow knows enough about opera so that he recognized immediately that was Nordica. He said, that's not Madame Sklar, that's Nordica, Virginia. And he said, you know, so we're talking about this and so on and so forth. What were the facts and so on? Whitney got a lot of his information from Louise Harris, who didn't like anybody. And she certainly didn't like the daughters because they weren't friendly. So he said to me, and I said, you know, well, that's the question. He said, that's the real question for the talk tonight at the Bethel Historical Society. He said, why are we having this conversation? Why are we talking about these people who are maybe real or maybe not real? or who when we read stories about them, the stories are maybe true or maybe not true, or maybe somewhat accurate or maybe not so accurate. Said, why is it that we're, why is it that I called you up? Why is it that you, in the middle of what's obviously a busy workday, have spent now 2 hours on the phone talking about whether or not these things are real or not real and so on? Well, I think that's the fundamental question. And I think the answer is this. Who does care? I think this is the answer. I'm going to read to you just the beginning paragraph or so about C.A. Stevens' story. I think this is a C.A. Stevens' story. It's signed Cyrus Waterhouse, but C.A. Stevens had dozens and dozens of pen names, and I'm convinced that this writer is indeed C.A. Stevens. This is from the Youth Companion on July 2nd, 1896. It's called His Sunday Job, and I didn't have enough of these because of this big paper. We didn't have enough of this big paper, but I brought some of these for the Historical Society, and maybe a few people will even fight over them. That's what life is really like. It's not like C.A. Stevens can fight over things. This is a story called His Sunday Job. It goes like this. The hired boy's story, it says, his experience with a real character in northern Maine. My father was a Maine farmer with a large family of boys and a small home farm. High farming work would not have been paid. High farming would not have paid at that time, and we were not so near a city that market gardening would have been a good place for us. So there was no way of using all of our labor on the place. Therefore, it was necessary for some of us to work, work out by the season and contribute our wages to the support of the family. I was 16 years old when I began to work out, first with one of my uncles, not far from home. He did not require me to work very hard, but then he did not pay me a full wage either. And he said he would not do so until the next spring, when I would be 17 years old and more ambitious. I thought I could do a man's work, and I should get a man's pay. So I set off one morning, about the middle of April, to find a place among strangers who would neither favor me nor get me to put up with half wages. Away I went, looking for a farmer who would hire me through the towns of Woodstock and Bethel in Oxford County. The candid farmers generally told me that I was too young, or that my muscles were not hardened up enough, or that I was too green and lathy. Such remarks on my personal condition and appearance made the first day rather disagreeable. I passed my first night away from home with an aunt who lived in at the corners called Pinhook in the northern part of Woodstock. Next morning, I plodded along very muddy roads through Milton Plantation and across the Androscoggin River by ferry to the town of Rumford, where the farmers all told me the same thing I had heard the day before. I passed the second night with another aunt in Rumford and entered the town of Mexico the next day. But the Mexicans would have none of me. The April afternoon was drawing to an end, and I had no dinner, and there was no aunt of mine within easy reach. What to do for food and shelter I could not think until I neared the border of the town of Roxbury, which lies next to and north of Mexico. Here a farmer, who did not wish to hire me himself, advised me to apply to one Uncle Ben Edmonds, who lived further on in Roxbury. The old man wants a hand, he added with a laugh. I guess he will take you. And he told me where the Edmonds farm was and how to get there. The story goes on, and what happens here is that he does get a job with Farmer Edmonds, who's quite a religious fellow, and Farmer Edmonds, to test the young man's determination and mettle, requires him, at the end of each day's work, to take a hammer and a chisel out to a big rock, of which there are a lot in Maine, and to carve a biblical inscription in the rock, as practice for his letters and also as practice just for being diligent. And the fellow then goes on to tell about how, in fact, this is a pretty odd thing to have done, but in the long run, it was interesting, it was good, and he learned a lot, and so on and so forth. Now, see, this here's the same question. Who cares? But I suspect that everyone here tonight wants to know. You see, we've got these details, and this is true, right? Pinhook is where he says it is, and the towns are lined up just right, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the details are such, and this is C.A. Stevens, the details are such that we are absolutely convinced that this is true. And because we're convinced that the details are true, then we easily take that leap into accepting the entire thing. Now, once we accept the entire thing, of course, he's got us reading the next story and the story after that. But yeah. I suspect that somebody in this room, I don't have time to do it, because and ask around, was there a guy who has these rocks with these inscriptions in them?
I bet that was Edmund Taylor. What do you think, Randy?
Yeah, Larry.
It says Edmund.
The rocks with the biblical inscriptions.
See?
Yes. Yeah,
right,
that
right next to the cemetery with my silver ancestors.
Right.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It was lots of fun.
Yeah, sure was.